into idolatry. But what we need to remember is that this month has been set aside. It begins a 40-day period of repentance. Now, one of the outcomes of repentance is to bring about a transformation. So the month of Elul is so that we can bring about a change from not being idol worshipers, but rather to return to the living God. Now, the important thing to know about this month is that rooted within it is the idea of the power of repentance. See, many people say, I'm sorry about my sin, I regret the consequences of my sin, but they really don't repent in the sense that they find intimacy with the living God. To get your Bible, look with me to the book of Luke and chapter 15. I promised you earlier today that we would talk about a Jewish parable, a parable that's related to repentance. And repentance is rooted in change. And one of you need to change something because I was told that someone's car's windows are down. So if your windows are down, it's raining. You know, I appreciate the clarification that that was thunder. I thought Hamas is really getting good with their rockets and getting all the way down there, but not yet. In Luke chapter 15, we see a parable that is familiar to all of us. But sometimes we miss out on the cultural backgrounds that this parable has within it. We read in verse 11, Messiah's teaching, and he says, there was a certain man who had two sons, and the younger said to his father, Father, give to me my portion of the inheritance. Now, some would hear that and think that's odd, because this father is still, what would you say? Alive. Now, the only reason that you would answer that way is because you're responding from a cultural norm of yours, but not in the scripture. It was a day of pride when a man would give all of his possessions to his sons. Because it was a day that he was saying to the community, my sons are mature, they are responsible, and I'm entrusting my life. You see, it's a statement that he's done a good job in raising his children. How many of you men would like to give all your possessions to your children and trust that they will be faithful with that money and will be able to provide for you the rest of your life? So when a father would do that, it was a statement that he had done a good job as a father training his children, learning them how to handle resources. Now, this is a little bit different because it did not initiate with the father, but the younger son. And one of the questions that we need to arrive at is why this son, why would he say it at the time that he did? But what's unique? He says, Father, give to me the portion of the inheritance that I deserve. And it says that the father indeed distributed all of his possessions. So he agreed. Verse 13. And after a few days, here's the key. After a short time, and usually that shows intent. That is to say that this younger son, he had all along this idea that he was going to do something when he got his portion of the inheritance. And what was that? Well, look again. Not after many days, the younger son, he gathered all that he had, and he went out to a far land. Now, that is an idiom. There's a very important Jewish word, Hebrew word, that you need to learn. It's the word galut. It means exile. When someone goes outside of Israel, every land is seen as a further land. Why is that? Because you're removing yourself from the location that God has called us. You're going into exile. Now, we would never want to choose exile, so this is problematic. He gets this inheritance, and inheritance is an important concept. It is to carry on the work of the Father. But he does something totally different. Instead of wanting to build his life in Eretz Israel, the land of Israel, he can't wait to leave, and he goes to exile. He goes to a faraway land, and there he squandered all that he had on riotous living. Now, here's the point we need to see. The reason why he wanted to leave the land of Israel is so that he could live in a way that was not condoned, was not practiced in the land of Israel. He wanted to live outside the biblical norms. He wanted to live outside the scriptural foundations. And that is related to that idolatrous tendency. Because people fall into idolatry because of selfishness. Did you realize that? There's an inherent relationship between selfishness and idolatry. What people would do would be this. They would go into the shop that sold idols, and they would say, well, tell me, how do I worship that idol? They would tell you what he liked. Oh, that's not what I want to do. Well, how do you worship this one? They would say, he likes this. I don't want to do that. And you would wait until you got to the idol that commanded his followers to do exactly what you wanted to do. And therefore, it was simply a way to justify, to rationalize your sinful nature. Some would say, that's sin. Oh, no, that's not sin. This is worship. And they could take pride in the delight of their flesh. So this young man, he left Israel in order that he could satisfy the desires of his flesh and that type of behavior. Verse 14. Now, that type, the phrase here, has to do with sin. And sin, don't miss this, sin is very expensive. Sin costs a great deal. Not just financially, but in every way possible. So we read, he squandered after a short time. It says there, and that's important. There, he squandered all of his possessions in riotous living, verse 14. And after he had done so, he squandered all. It says, and there came a great famine in where? That land. Over and over, there are references to that land. And every time, and I mean every time that land is mentioned, something bad, something ungodly, something outside of God's will is taking place. Well, notice something. At the worst possible time, I mean, when a famine comes, prices go up. They go up. So when things are getting more expensive, at that time that he lost everything, it couldn't have come at a worse time. And what I want you to see is this. When we're walking in sin, when we're pursuing our desires, it prepares us for failure. It positions us at the worst possible location at the worst possible time. But when you walk in obedience to the will of God, when you apply truth to your life, well, what happens? Look at a piece of scripture. Look to it to Psalm 37. Psalm 37 and verse 25. Now, this is a well-known verse. In fact, we quote this verse three times a day. After you eat, now this is different because if you don't come from a biblical background, I almost said Jewish background, but I want to change that. If you don't come from a biblical background, you're going to miss out on so much. Why do I say that? Well, it tells us in the scripture that we are to eat our food. When we're satisfied, give thanks to the Lord. Now, most people in the world, most Christians, what do they pray in regard to their food? Before. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. In Judaism, there's also a short blessing. But after you eat, biblically, the book of Deuteronomy says, when you have tasted your food and are satisfied, give thanks to God. So, three times a day, lunch, breakfast, and dinner, at the end, there's these blessings that we say, and it ends with this verse, verse 25. I have been young, and also now I'm old, and I have not seen the righteous, and that term righteous means those who apply the Word of God to their life. I have not seen the righteous forsaken, or his seed, what? Begging bread. That is this. When we apply God's Word to our life, it's going to position us where God wants us to be. It is going to lead us to be prepared for the future. But when we apply sin to our life, we're going to have the very worst timing that you can imagine. That's what sin does. It leads us to despair. It leads us to want. Let's go back to Luke 15. After he had squandered all, there came this great famine in the land, and he began to be in want. Verse 15. Now, he did something. He attached himself to one of the residents, here it is again, of what? That land. Now, he's in need, and instead of going to a Jew, and I want to be very careful here, because when I use that term Jew, I'm talking about a son of Jacob, in a very general sense. You see, the sons of Jacob, they inherited, because it went from Abraham to Abraham's children? No. Didn't go to Abraham's children. If it went to Abraham's children, who else would be included? Ishmael. And went from Abraham to Isaac, that heritage, from Isaac to his sons? No. Because it did, it would include Esau to Jacob. And then that heritage went upon the children of Jacob, and there was a call. That heritage is what? To be a blessing. If you are in need, let me tell you, the best place to be is in Israel. Because according to Jewish law, when someone asks you for help, you got to give. Now, it doesn't say how much you have to give, but you have to give. If you're in need in Israel, if you're hungry, I mean, the best city to be in is Jerusalem. There's one food kitchen after another. No one has to go hungry in Israel. You go to a synagogue during one of the prayer times, if you have a need, that need is going to be met. So what does he do? Instead of looking for a fellow Jew, what happens? It says in the scripture that he goes and he attaches himself to one of the residents of that land, and he was sent, this one sent him into feed what? The swine. Now, here again, we know that pigs in general have a very negative connotation in Judaism. And so what is he doing? Instead of being a light to the nations, instead of being a teacher of truth, instead of being a blessing, he's taking care of who? Pigs. Now, from a biblical mindset, we look at that and we say, you can't get much lower than that. And sometimes for people to regain the biblical perspective, they have to hit rock bottom. Now, why do we say that? Remember Isaiah's call? God says, who I send? Should I send? Isaiah says, send me. God gives him a call, and it's a difficult one. He says, speak so the people won't hear. You know, give them ears so they can't listen, and so forth. What is it all about? He's saying that until we see a real change, they are to go all the way down. There's a very important scripture. Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 7. Now, everyone in Israel knows that verse. Et sarahi le'Yaakov u'memena yivashia, which simply means, it's a time of tribulation for who? Jacob. Now, what? Why does God allow? Why does he bring about the events that Jacob, Israel, will go through this time of tribulation? And by the way, Daniel tells us in Daniel chapter 12 that this time of tribulation at the end will be the worst, don't miss this, will be the worst time of tribulation for Israel ever, ever. Why? Because God wants to capture Israel's attention. He wants them to repent, truly repent. And unfortunately, it's going to be all of this hardship, these trials, the worst time that is going to give rise. What does it say? Et serat hi le Yaakov, a time of trouble it is for Jacob, umemena, but from it. And it literally means, and because of this, it's the only way. Because of this, he will be saved. And in the same way, this young man, he had to hit rock bottom before he began to consider things from God's perspective. And one of the things that we need to be asking ourselves each and every day is this, every day. Am I looking at things from God's perspective? Or am I trying to manipulate God to do things from my perspective? What I hear so much today, and so many pulpits and some of the most popular books that are supposed to be based upon scriptural truth, is how to get, in a nutshell, it tells how to get God to do your will. He doesn't do it. And that's why so many people, they get all excited when they come to faith. They hear these things, and then what happens? Their faith becomes shriveled. Because they fall into frustration and discouragement. They think God doesn't love them anymore because they were told, if I do A, B, and C, God's going to give me what I want. God's not interested in giving you your will. He's got a better will, His will for your life. So we need to come to His perspective. Again, verse 16. There, again that word, there, in that location, in that country, there, he had, and he uses a very strong word, he had a great desire, he was in need, and he longed to be full, to fill his stomach with the various pods and such that the pigs were eating. I mean, if you ask him, what do you want? I'd like to be a pig. I'd like to receive what they're receiving. Now, that's getting pretty far down, isn't it? Not? Because I don't have a lot of experience with pigs. But they eat what? Anything. Just throw it. And he was willing to do that same thing. But no one, what does the scripture say? No one gave him nothing. Now, there's a mitzvah in Israel to bless, to love your neighbor as yourself. No one's doing that there. Why? He's in that country. Verse 17. Now, the month of Elul is the month that something is commanded to be done according to the rabbis. La'asot cheshbon nefesh. The word cheshbon is an accounting term. It can be used today in modern Hebrew for a bill, for a reckoning. The word nefesh is related to the spiritual side. So when the month of Elul enters into to being, something's done. It's also known as the month of the shofar. Now, many people think you just blow the shofar when? Rosh Hashanah. No. We hear the shofar sounded for 40 days. From the first day of Elul, 30 days, plus the 10 days of repentance, that's 40. And then, one more time, on Yom Kippur. So, we read in verse 17, and when he, what does your Bible say, comes to his senses, much richer than that. He does cheshbon nefesh. He considers things from God's perspective. And when he did so, he says, how many of my father's hired servants, they have bread, b'shefa. You know that word, shefa? In abundance. Now, the sages would tell us that this word shefa is related to the kingdom. Why do I say this? Well, today's Shabbat, right? When Shabbat is over, what do? There's a service. Havdalah. And one of the elements is we take a cup, we take some wine, and we pour how much wine into the cup?
Overflowing.
Kos Yeshua. A cup of abundant salvation. And if you look at the instructions in the Siddur, most will say that you pour beshefa. You put in abundance. This term is related to what? The kingdom. Because in the kingdom, we're not going to have any shortage. In the kingdom, we're not going to worry about that which is lacking. It's a kingdom of abundance. When Messiah talked about life in the kingdom, he says, I came that you may have life and have it how? Abundantly. So this man begins to think, and he begins to think about life at home, life in Israel, life that reflects a kingdom principle. And he says, here, the servants here eat worse than the pigs. No one cares for them. But in my Father's house, i.e. the kingdom, in my Father's house, the servants, not even the family, but the servants, they have bread in abundance. And he says, I am dying. What does your Bible say? Here. Every time there's a reference to that country, it's death. It's lacking. Always negative. And I am dying in this country in famine. Now, famine is synonymous in the scripture with curse. Because he has left his heritage, he's experiencing God's curse. So he's going to repent, heshbon nefesh. He's going to repent, and he's going to return. Verse 18. I will rise up, and I will go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have, and this is so hard for people to say sometimes, I was wrong. I used poor judgment. I made a mistake. Is that what he says? I have sinned. Now it's becoming very rare today that people will talk about sin. If you look at the largest church in America, their pastor will not speak on sin. But the Bible speaks often. Messiah taught frequently about the consequences of sin, the solution to sin. He says, for I have sinned against heaven and against you. Notice the order. Heaven first. He understood first and foremost that his life choices were against God. And until we realize that our life, left to ourselves, left to our perspective, left to our desires, we are going to always be sinning against him. And until we come to that recollection, it's not going to bring about anything positive in our life. So he says, I have sinned against heaven and against you. Now, all of this is what he's rehearsing. What he intends to say, he says, I am no longer worthy to be called anymore a son. Now, look up for a moment. That word son. There's a couple different meanings of this word son. And one of the meanings is an heir. Now, what I want to emphasize is that he realizes that he has failed his father. How many of us have failed our heavenly Father? The fact that we need redemption speaks to that very clearly. And here's the problem. We learn the truth here, but we seldom apply that. Because what he's saying is, I would have come back and I just want to be a servant. I am no longer an heir. My status has changed. I am no longer part of the family because of what I have done. But I want to come back and live there as a servant. How many of us really are faith, what people are saying today? How many really emphasize service? We all come to faith most of the time, what we hear on television stuff, based upon what we're going to get from it. He just wanted provision. He didn't want that same status as an heir. He simply wanted the opportunity to serve because he knew the servants of his fathers fare better than anyone else in exile, outside. So he says, I am not worthy any longer to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired servants. Verse 1. And he rises and he goes to his father, but when he's still at a distance. Now that's important. He is nowhere close to his home. He's still far away, but what happens? The scripture says, his father sees him. Now, this word for see, many times it's used in regard to vision. So his father has a vision. I can't see far away, but God can reveal it. Most people understand this to mean that the father is doing something. From the day that that younger son left, what do you think the father's been doing? He knew his son. He knew where he was spiritually. The fact that soon thereafter he left to go to a foreign land, he went into exile. That father knew what his spiritual condition was. And when your children are far removed from the will of God, what should you be doing? Praying. I believe that's what it's telling us here. This father was praying day in, day out for his son's spiritual condition, and God revealed to him, when he was still far away, he revealed that his son was on his way home. And notice the outcome. And he was just like we heard sung that last song, he was filled with what? Mercy or compassion. Now, he wasn't thinking about his loss. Because this loss that he was receiving was only physical. It was only a temporal loss. It was done with the things of this world, not the things of the kingdom. It wasn't his focus. He had mercy for him, and he, what does your Bible say, what did he do? He ran. Unique. Very few people run in the scripture. Very few. Two come to mind. I'm going to share one of them, and that's Abraham. In Genesis 18, Abraham is recovering from his Brit Milah, his circumcision. It's the heat of the day, and he sees three men passing. Now, if you look at a siddur sometime, that is a prayer book, you will find that there's certain commandments that are elevated in Judaism. One is, and if you've ever been in Israel, you don't have to be there too long until someone comes up and says, give me a little bit of money because my children are getting married. Now, I remember being with someone and they said, well, why didn't you save money for it? Why aren't you prepared? They didn't understand the message of this. Helping someone with a marriage is a marriage, it relates to what? The kingdom. You look sometime at the book of Revelation. When the kingdom is established, it's going to be seen, it's pictured as a festival. What type of festival? Marriage festival. It is a glorious event. So they're not saying necessarily, give me money because I can't afford to do this. It's an opportunity to participate in the marriage festival. To have a role. Why? It's seen as an important commandment, an important thing, marriage. Secondly, we see something else. We see in this passage of scripture, when we read here, that Abraham ran, to entertain guests. Which means hospitality. Being hospitable is seen as a great mitzvah. So Abraham, he sees these people passing by. If you're talking, my mom, she doesn't like guests. People call up, I'm in the neighborhood, visiting. Well, we're busy. I wish you would have known this call me sooner, but I can't do anything today. Abraham, he sees these men, and their intent is what? To pass by. And what does he do? He runs after them. 100-year-old man. Running's unique. And this is what this individual does. He runs, his father runs, full of compassion. He falls upon his neck, another expression, the hug, and he kissed him. And the son began to say that speech that he rehearsed, right? His son says to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Stop right there. Then went past that. The father, he wasn't interested in hearing. Once he saw, he knew the spiritual condition, this change. And therefore, verse 22, but, and that's an important but the father said to his servants, bring quickly the finest garments. Now, garments are important in the scripture. We saw that earlier. But garments can relate to works or deeds. When someone has no good deeds in the scriptures, they're called naked. The book of Revelation talks about those who are naked. It's an expression, an idiom that has to do with being shamed because you have no good works, nothing to show in faith. So he's getting the what? What type of robe is he getting? The best. best robe. Why? Well, it's to show us the power of repentance. Repentance brings about a major change in our life. It transforms us. So we see this fine robe also. It says, place upon him the ring. What type of ring? The signet ring. Now that's important. Because that ring was a family ring which gave the person who wore it full authority over everything. Someone who has a signet ring, they can make any business decision that they want, obligate the family for anything. And you know what he was saying? See, oftentimes someone messes up and we say, well, I'm going to put you on probation. If you can prove to me. Now, when someone does that, you know what they're saying? I really don't believe it. But this father, he understood the power and the transformation of true repentance. And therefore, immediately, he gave to him the signet ring, saying, I trust you fully. It was a full restoration of this boy back into the family. And he says one other thing. Put shoes upon him. That says something. Because you know how you know when someone's really poor? They don't have shoes. I mean, you've been to large cities. You've seen homeless people. But the ones who are the poorest, they have no shoes. This man had no shoes. He says, put on shoes and bring the fattened calf and kill it. And we will eat and what? Be merry or glad. Now, look at another passage of Scripture. Look to the previous verse of this passage, verse 10. Same chapter. Verse 10. Yeshua is speaking and he says, for I say to you thus, that the joy that will be with the angels in God, the angels in heaven, the angels of God, will be great over one sinner that repents. Now we all know that verse. You mean heaven is going to be excited? There's going to be great joy over how many people that repent?
One.
Now it begins the passage. Our passage is sandwiched by that. We see gladness, rejoicing in verse 10, and now we come to one end of this, the first end of this passage, and it ends as well with great joy. Verse 24, for my son was dead, now he is returned to life. He was lost and he's found, and they began to be glad. Now, what was going on? Well, I would summarize it as a party. Why? Verse 25. That same hour, the older son, we haven't heard anything about him yet. The older son was in the field. He returned, and he approached the house, and he heard the sounds of music and joy. Let me translate that. A party was going on. Now, I went to college. College has parties down there. And I never recall what anyone heard. Hey, there's a party, and you got the address. I never recall what anyone saying, well, why is there a party? What are we celebrating? No one ever says that. What do? They just go. If there's rejoicing, you want to be part of that. But what happens? Notice how different this older son is. Verse 26. He called to one of the younger servants. He asked to know, what was this? That is, what's the cause of this joy? And this young man returned. He answered and said, your brother has returned. And your father even has slaughtered the fattened calf. Because he has returned safe and sound. He has returned back. In other words, to the proper perspective. And look at verse 28. That older son, what does it say about him? He was angry. Now, do you see the difference? We look at verse 10. What's going on in verse 10 in the heavens?
Joy.
What's going on in the house?
Joy.
So, that house in heaven, there's an agreement. They're agreeing, a sinner who repents, joy. This older brother comes and he has 180 degrees different approach. He is angry. He's heard the same news that everyone else heard, but he is angry. The older son, he was angry and he did not want to what? Go in. He wanted nothing to do with this. Now the father. The father hearing this, presumably, he goes out. He goes out and he speaks to his son. Literally it says, he goes out in order to speak. Doesn't say anything yet. He comes out to speak to his son, but before he can say anything, what happens? Verse 29. The son says to his father, behold, these many years I have worked here, and I have never transgressed one of your commandments. You believe that? You believe that? Never, all these many years, and I have never transgressed anything. I've been perfect. You know what? I've never met a perfect person, but I know one thing. I despise to meet people who think they're perfect. I don't want to be around them. And I suggest to you, perhaps, that this younger brother did not want to be around his perfect, and I use that term loosely, his perfect older brother. And he says something very important here. He says further on, he says, and you have never given to me a kid goat in order that I might rejoice with who? With my friends. This is extremely problematic. This says so much. Now, let's go back for a moment. This younger brother, he got all of this inheritance. And what did he do? He left. He didn't want to stay in Israel. He didn't want to stay at home. He wanted to go another place so he could do what he couldn't do at home. That's problematic, right? Well, this older brother's no different. Because he says, you never gave me even a kid goat in order that I might marry here at home. He didn't want to make joy at home. He wanted to do it with what? His friends. Now, it says a lot. When someone says, you know, I don't want to have fun at home. I want to go out. I remember when I was a teenager, said, I'm going over to such and such's home. His parents weren't there. And my mom would say, well, have your friends come over to our house. I didn't want that. Why? Because what we were planning on doing, and that one home, that no one was there, no adults were there, we couldn't do at my home because my parents were. See how that works? Same thing here. He wanted to make joy, merry, so-called, with his friends, but not at that place. Now, he's no different than his brother. He just does a good job covering up his sin. And there's many people like that. See, some people, their sin, they just wear their sin everywhere they go. And there's other people, we look nice, we know how to speak, but we just hide the sin. It's still there. And that's the case with this young man. Same thing, the older brother. Verse 30. But when this son of yours, won't even call him his brother, when this son of yours who spends your wealth with what? Prostitutes. Now, we know, because the scripture tells us, that he did things in that faraway country that was not good. We know that. But does his brother know that for sure? No. There's no way that the brother knows what this son or this brother of his has done. And notice what he does here. He says, when this son of yours spends all your wealth, what do you think he's trying to do? The father, he wasn't thinking about his financial loss. But who was? The brother. That wasn't the older brother's. That was his younger brother's money. It was done. But he was trying to sow seeds of discourse between that young boy and his father. So he says, when you have seen this, verse 30, when he has spent all of his wealth, your wealth, on prostitutes, you go and you fatten the calf, you slay the fattened calf for him. Verse 31. But the father said, my son, you are always with me. That is, you have everything. Everything is yours. But it was proper for us to rejoice and be glad because your brother that was dead spiritually has returned to life. He's gathered once again a godly perspective. He was lost and he is found. Now I'm going to close this first message by asking, how do you know that you've been found? How do you know that truly you belong to God? And you know what the answer is? What we've seen over and over in this passage, joy. A joy that the world does not understand. The night before I got married, we had a get-together, and I saw a friend of my father's. He's a contractor. And I had not seen him for almost 30 years, but I ran into him in Chicago. And I asked, what are you doing up here? He said, I had a little business, and we talked, and no big deal. Well, I found out that he went up to Chicago because he signed a contract for over $200 million for his construction company. Would that make you happy? That's pretty good. You would have never known it. There was no joy. There was no... Now, this was his largest contract ever. He's very successful. But it didn't make him happy. In fact, he was saying how hard it was and how underhanded people were. I mean, he wasn't happy at all. Now, the difference is this. See, this is one of the miracles of God. That God can cause you to be joy over the things that the world would never take joy in. That God can sustain us, that we can know contentment in simply the fact that we belong to Him. I shared last night with some of you that Tuesday when I flew into New York, my bag took over an hour and a half to arrive at that place. And I had nothing to do that day, for at the time the bag was supposed to, I had 13 hours before I had to be someplace. Nothing to do. But when I saw other people, they got theirs. She got hers. Where's mine? Lo and behold, everyone's gone. Everyone's gone. I'm there by myself. How unfair. Why me? What? So I went up to the little counter and they said, your bag is coming. It was placed by mistake on a wrong bin, a wrong little tree. We're going to be praying. Just wait. It's coming. Half an hour, still wasn't there. I go back up and I complain. Sir, it's coming. We're sorry. It's coming. So I go and right there where it comes out. Lo and behold, a woman comes up to me. And she says, can I ask you, I see that on your head. Can I ask you a question? Why not? She asks this question concerning the Holy Spirit. And it's a very simple question. And I shared with her, and we talked for about 30, 40 minutes. And I couldn't believe when she heard this very simple, any of you could have answered it, she was just overjoyed. And I saw just the joy that came upon her. You know, joy is a little bit contagious. And right after, and she said, I know, she's from New York, she knows a little bit about Judaism, she says, I just gotta hug you. This old lady face, 65, sorry ladies, but she just hugged me. And she's just beaming. And she turns around, I turn, and just plop. What happened? My bad. Now, what I heard, and I'm not a real touchy-feely guy. I don't hear things from the Lord frequently. But what was touching my spirit was simply this. You had nothing to do today. Nothing. I was going to get to the hotel. My room wouldn't be ready. I was going to sit in the lobby until it was. Nothing to do. And God, I believe, delayed my bag. It said, where it should go. Why did that guy put it on the wrong bin? Maybe God just orchestrated that so that I could have that private time with that woman. And when I saw how joyful and how God orchestrated this, in my opinion, you know what it was? When I checked into the hotel, the lady says, boy, you must be having a good day. And it dawned on me. I was so angry about this bed. How stupid. We get angry over the stupidest things. How unfair. So often, when something's unfair, we think, you know what it is? God just moving in our life. God wanting to arrange something so that you and I, that we can be servants of Him and maybe bless someone. And here's the point. When I just saw things from His perspective and how He used some just simple biblical truth to bless someone else, it made me so joyful. And I had more joy over just that little bit. I was able to bless someone. I had so much more joy than my dad's friend who signed a $220 million contract. Now, if you're more joyful over that, having to wait an hour and a half for your bag, if you're more joyful than over signing, who's that? It's God. When you know that God is using you, it means everything. And that's what this passage speaks to, repentance. What's repentance? Last sentence. Repentance is saying to God, God, I want you to use me. And then what happens is this, if you're like me, when God begins to do that, what do? Complain. What? I thought you had repented. I thought you said your life, that is my life, is now His life. Do with my life what you want. God said, I wanted you to talk to that lady that day. I got everyone away from you so you could have a private conversation. And what was I doing? Complaining. A month of renewal. God wants to bring a transformation to us that He might use us to cause others to experience the joy that God has given to us, that joy of salvation. Father God, we praise You that You can beget repentance in each of us. That there's still things that You want to transform in our being, in our soul, in our spirit, because You have work for us. And Lord, forgive us that we focus too much upon our lives, our agenda, what we want to do, rather than saying, God, use me. God, use me to be a blessing to others. That I might listen to someone who's hurting. That I might give a word of encouragement. That I might babysit a single mom's child so that she might be able to go out and have a few minutes of just time alone. Whatever. So many simple things can be such a great blessing to others. Lord, we thank You that You provide for us so that we might be a provision for others. In the blessed name of our Lord and Savior, Messiah Yeshua, we all say, amen. Well, we're